Hey everyone, we wanted to study the life cycle of vulnerabilities, but we also wanted to understand what causes vulnerabilities to be exploited, to have signatures written for them, what kinds of states can they live in. And to do that, we decided to look at the entire vulnerability landscape that we could get publicly and layer onto that all of the data that Kenna Security has about that, which looks like a lot of scan data, a lot of exploitation data, a lot of events, actual scans of enterprises, actual exploitations in the wild. And combining all of those, what we really hope to do is we hope to come up with a strategy for vulnerability remediation that is both measured in a way that's systematic and you can measure at home. So one of the key takeaways here will be a framework for thinking about what you're doing back home, whether that's efficient, whether that's effective, whether that's the best use of your resources, and what kind of data you need to get to make those measurements. But the other takeaway will be the answer to the question of how do you do vulnerability remediation right? What should you be focusing on? What is it that causes a vulnerability to be a risk and not just a write-up of a software flaw?
And I want to give some background real quick too before we get to the data sources. So I work at Cyentia Institute and Michael's at Kenna. And we have a business relationship where my company is doing a lot of the data research and helping Michael and his company with publications. And there are two out there currently, and there's a third one coming out next week. And we're going to talk about some of the things that we've uncovered in that research. And then at the end here, we're going to get into what contributes to that exploitation, which is stuff I think we'll probably be publishing in the next year or so.
Yeah, absolutely. A lot of the charts you'll see here are from those reports, and the way that we think about them is, what can we look at across our customer data, and what can we give you as insights from that data set?
Yeah.
Which is a good segue into where does this data come from. So vulnerabilities themselves are really just write-ups of software flaws. It's a document that describes an issue with a piece of software. A CVE is a vulnerability in a known piece of software that's reported to the National Vulnerability Database. A CWE is a weakness. Every CVE is really a type of weakness, but it's a more general abstract thing. The data here comes from National Vulnerability Database, from all of the scanning vendors, so Tenable, Nessus, Rapid7, Qualys, all of them are scanning for different weaknesses that they know about for different vulnerabilities. But on top of that, we also want to know about what's happening to those vulnerabilities in the threat environment. So I think of it as we have two data sets. One is the detect and respond side of the house, which is IDS signatures matching vulnerabilities, exploitation events, malware reversals that are tied to particular vulnerabilities. Those are events of exploitation that a SOC analyst would typically have to respond to. And on this side, the prevent and predict side of the house, we have all of the asset infrastructure, all of the vulnerability scan data, all of the ways in which enterprises discover vulnerabilities and address them. These two data sets together we're going to pair to do analysis and figure out what is it exactly about a vulnerability that is important and risky. The data set that we're looking at is about 7.3 billion exploitation events, and we think of those as anything from a signature was triggered on a box, or a signature was triggered on a box and we know that the vulnerability that it was attacking was present, that's more likely to be successful. It could be a piece of malware was reversed by Reversing Labs or Symantec, and we know that it was tied to a particular Java exploit. We pair that with a different data set. So these are not from the same enterprises, but the relationships between them are important. And the different data set is 2.8 billion scanned vulnerabilities across 13 million assets. An asset can be a database, a server, a phone, or it can be like a routing switch or a Linux box of any kind. Anything that you could scan with a Qualys is something that's going into this data set. And what's interesting is that not every vulnerability out there is scanned, not every vulnerability out there is exploited, and certainly not every vulnerability out there poses a risk to your organization. You want to walk through this guy?
Yeah, so that was, this is hopefully going to help understand what Michael just said. So at the very top, you get a vulnerability that is discovered. And we're not really gonna focus on 0 days, although 0 days at some point are discovered, of course, maybe not publicly. But then once it's discovered and it's public, it's published, it's out there, what you see, we start to get this metadata, right? We get, as Michael mentioned, NVD, the MITRE lists the CVE, you get the CVSS, CPE, CWE, you get all this metadata around that vulnerability. Now, once it's out there, there's several things that can occur. First, you might see a vulnerability signature exists in scanners, and then we may or may not observe it in the wild, the actual open vulnerability. We may get signature generation for IDS, IPS, other detection techniques. That signature may exist, and once that exists, then we may see it actually exploited in the wild. It may have an exploit published. So ExploitDB, Metasploit, there are several other frameworks that an exploit may be published in, and we try to capture that as well. And then also, there may be a patch, and whether that patch exists or not, and then we can also look for when it's patched in reality. Now, the problem is, all we see is the bottom part of these two on the left. All we see is when a vulnerability is observed, or it's seen in some sort of detection being exploited. And so what we don't know is if the signature actually exists. So I put these boxes together here on the left and said, all we know is that something was observed, or we don't know if there's a signature, right? So that's sort of the two states in the bottom there. So as we get into this, one of the first things we want to do is look at the landscape, right, to understand what does this look like. And so we created the next chart that looked at the rate of publications across the CVE landscape. And this is from MITRE. And now, don't look at this and think it's getting worse. Look at these peaks. Look at these valleys. What I wanted to do is just say, what does it look like? Right? We want to sort of set that foundation. So actually, what you're seeing here is that 2005, if I had to guess, I think that MITRE got some help in their process of intaking vulnerabilities. You see these weird spikes here, and those are probably individual researchers getting overzealous in their submissions. And then you see in 2017 this large spike here. You see essentially the CNA process kicking up, and that is essentially before then, essentially MITRE was the front door. In order to get a CVE number, you had to go through MITRE. Now we've got the CNA process. Now there's lots of front doors. So we're not seeing an explosion in vulnerabilities. We're probably seeing an explosion in the recording of vulnerabilities. But this is good to know. It's good to keep this in mind for what we're seeing, because this is essentially the landscape that we're looking at.
It's interesting to note that you saw four different states that the vulnerability could go into in this chart before. Let me actually back up to this thing. Oh. There's four different states that it could be in. It could be a vulnerability is observed, it's exploited in the wild, an exploit exists, or the patch is applied, or the patch exists. But all of those states are time independent. So all of them could be happening at once, or none of them could be happening, or they could happen, only two of them. Maybe the signature exists and the exploit exists, but there's no patch that exists for them. It's not a linear process, it's an or statement here. And that's what leads us to see things like this. The moment a CVE is published, that vulnerability could have an exploit published before we ever know about the vulnerability, or it could have an exploit published after. But what's important is that the clustering all happens around the publication date. So the moment the vulnerability is released, the chance that an exploit is out there is the highest, and then it trails off afterwards. Attackers certainly revisit vulnerabilities, and there's certainly 0 days that we only know about because the exploit was published in the first place. But overall, it's around the publication date.
All right, so one of the things that we want to look at is the relationship between the exploit exists and its exploit in the wild, right? So when we look at the whole collection of CVEs, this is something we did, this is probably like last fall.
This is the first report, right?
Yeah, so this is just under 100,000 CVEs. And one thing that we found, about three quarters, about 77% of CVEs have no published exploit and have not been exploited in the wild. And this poses sort of a challenge, because essentially when you get your vulnerability scanner, you get a whole bunch of things, three quarter of those, from this type of measurement anyway, are not being exploited. Now over on the right, what we see is about 21% has an exploit publicly released, that is the code, or it's weaponized in Metasploit. And then at the top, that thin green area is about 0.6% of CVEs have executed exploits in the wild without something being published also. Very thin slice. And then about 1.2% have both been exploited in the wild and have a published exploit. Together, just under 2% have been exploited in the wild over all of these. So about 2% of the published CVEs have been exploited in the wild, have been observed to be exploited in the wild. So that's going to create an interesting challenge. Now, we can look at this in another way, and that is to look at, does the vulnerability actually exist? Do we see this particular CVE from scanners? And so on the left, these are the ones that are being observed. They're being picked up by scanners. All of these on the right are not. And so you can see the purple squares up here. One square is about 1,000 CVEs here. The purple squares are not observed, yet they're being exploited, or there's exploit code for them, which I think is pretty interesting. On the left side, you see a lot of things out there in the blue, the dark blue, that are not being exploited but are in environments. But what we really care about are those red squares up there. They're in environments and they're being exploited. They have exploit code out there.
So there's a really interesting way to think about this from a vulnerability management program perspective. The only things that your scanners will pick up is the left-hand side. And of those, what is real risk is the little red. But it's also true that scanners aren't picking up everything that you need to be worried about. And so the purple is all of the, it's kind of a story of two icebergs. You've got the iceberg of, I'm scanning everything, and I think I should be remediating everything. That's not true. Data from the detect and response side from those events is telling us only a small portion of them are actually being exploited, about 2%. But moreover, scanners aren't writing signatures for every vulnerability that's out there, and yet some of those have actual live exploitation events that we see in the wild. A different way to look at this is to look at slicing down this problem. And so if you look at the chart and the CNA process and MITRE getting better and faster at publishing vulnerabilities, that might look daunting. You know, Jay says we're just assessing it, but there are more and more of them coming out, and scanners are picking up more and more of them to scan. But if you really look at that, and this is across all of those vulnerabilities, the 13 million assets that we've seen, only 37,000 out of the 108,000 published CVEs are ever picked up by a scanner. And so the total addressable size of the problem is actually much smaller than that first chart with a lot of CVEs coming out in 2019 and 2018 leads us to believe. And the solution to that problem, or at the very least the very first slice to that problem, is to look at those vulnerabilities that do have exploits, and that's only the red, only the 5,000 here. And you can even drill down further and say, of these, which ones are being exploited, and that number gets even smaller, it's only about a couple thousand.
And one of the interesting thing to look at, so when we see it in the wild, we do not, when we see a vulnerability in the wild, we do not see it evenly spread. And so this is showing how many assets are affected by a single CVE. And it's a distribution here. So you can see over on the left, about 8% of the CVEs that we've seen as a vulnerability in the wild, about 8% of those are less than 10 assets out of the, I can't remember how many million or billion, but over on the right, we see about 3% of CVEs affected more than 1 million assets each. So it's a really long tail. This is on a log scale. Everything's going up by 10 here. So it's a relatively flat. We get a peak here about 10,000, but it's interesting to know that these things are not equal. The fact that we're seeing a vulnerability, we're going to see some of them a whole bunch, and then some of them much less. But there's going to be this really long tail, these really widespread vulnerabilities over on the right here.
And this is interesting because it's not a statement about vulnerabilities at all. It's actually a statement about software proliferation. So there is a power law, or a very fat tail, of software that enterprises are using in that data set of 12 million assets. And some vulnerabilities will affect just about everybody. Those are the ones that pose the biggest risk, or at the very least, the biggest target of opportunity for attackers. And then past that, you can see that people have different technologies. Some vulnerabilities affect only one or two of our customers, or only a couple of those assets in that data set. And so now we want to start looking at intersections of these types of data to try to figure out what's causal, what's a correlation, what can we infer about that exploitation, so that when vulnerabilities come out and we don't know much about them, we can still make pretty intelligent statements about them. So right now we're going to look at exploitation in the wild as it relates to some of the metadata that we know about. Because if you take a step back 20 years or so to the creation of CVSS, this metadata about vulnerabilities was about all we had to go off of. And this is functionally what CVSS is. We have some descriptions or some of the variables that we can read about in the document that is a vulnerability. And based off of that, we make decisions about whether we remediate it or not, about what our policies are, about what PCI means. And I think that some of those decisions we might have jumped the gun on, or at least we didn't have the data to really assess whether they're efficient or not. Today we do. So the most basic thing that we can look at is, how well does a CVSS score work? If you prioritize real-life vulnerabilities using CVSS, what percentage of those are actually going to be exploited in the wild? And the data is pretty damning. It says if you remediate a CVSS 10 vulnerability, one of the CVSS 10 vulnerabilities that we have seen live scanned in from those 12 million assets, then the chance that that vulnerability has an exploit or is exploited is only 17.6%. That means that 1 in 5 of your CVSS 10 remediations is actually addressing a real risk that's out there. And this is empirical, this isn't theoretical based on the National Vulnerability Database or ExploitDB, this is based on what do we see scanned in from enterprises and how are their decisions affecting them. And if you look throughout CVSS, the distribution of risk within it, or at the very least your efficiency of choosing a different score or a different score cutoff, it varies, but it's all under 20%. So the best type of decision that you could make using a CVSS cutoff, no matter how much work you put in, will still mean that 4 out of your 5 remediations are remediations that are spent remediating vulnerabilities that maybe you don't care about first, or maybe you shouldn't be targeting in the beginning. And so the rest of this talk, what we want to do is we want to look through all of the other metadata, all of the other combinations of exploitation, patching, exploit exists, the metadata that we have about vulnerabilities, we're going to add some metadata later, to try to figure out if CVSS isn't working, if that's not a good strategy, what is?
Yeah. And let's talk about products, though, for a second. Remember we had that distribution that showed, what, about 3% or over 1 million out there? When we start counting up the vendor's role in the vulnerability landscape, there are 3 that really stick out. And this shouldn't be a surprise, right? Anybody who works in the space knows that Oracle, Microsoft, and Adobe have that proliferation out there. But what is interesting here is that when we actually dig into these and we look at, first, we've looked over the years, what we see is that Oracle here in red has a pretty long history. A lot of the open vulnerabilities from 2013, 2014 dominated by Oracle. And this is largely dominated by Java. And anybody who's worked with Java knows that when you patch it, generally you break stuff, right? So this is why we're seeing Oracle on top. And when we look at the distribution, though, on the next slide, what's really interesting is that Microsoft seems to be doing really well. When we look at the amount of vulnerabilities, Microsoft, if you look at that line on the left on the bottom, Microsoft has 1.2, 1.3 billion vulnerabilities. The gray part has been closed. When we look at the proportion, Microsoft has closed 3/4 of the vulnerabilities out there. Oracle has about 2/3 still open. Right? And so this, now we can actually get past how widespread is Microsoft and Oracle and get into how are they actually doing as a proportion of what we're seeing relative to their size. And so I think this is really interesting as we look at that aspect.
And what's interesting is that it's not Microsoft that is patching these vulnerabilities, right? It's all of you, it's all of the enterprises. What a statement like this over time shows us is that perhaps they're enabling patching better, and we know that through the deployment of Microsoft patches compared to Oracle patches, but it's good that we're actually seeing in the wild that people are using the tools that are given to them and are actually seeing results from them.
And I mentioned Java being on the top, and we're definitely seeing that. So out of all the Java products, JRE, JDK, et cetera, about 18% or so of the vulnerabilities that we see open are in Java. Then Acrobat from Adobe comes in there, and then various Windows things. There's some other Oracle things like the Enterprise Linux server down there. But for the most part, this is what we're seeing from a product perspective. And so Java is definitely at the top here of the heap for being going unpatched, having open vulnerabilities.
Right. And let us not forget the bias in how we're getting this data to begin with. It's only the things that scanners are writing signatures for and the things that are actually being scanned. So of course everybody's going to be scanning their production Oracle databases first. And if you have a Qualys deployment that's 10% of your infrastructure, it'll focus on that. And of course, the first things that Qualys will write signatures for are these kinds of things that are either easy to write signatures for or important to write signatures for.
All right, let's take a quick aside on remediation times. One of the things that we're able to do is to look at the patch rate, how quickly our company's patching. And this is from the report that's coming out next week, the research effort. But what we're seeing, this is called a survival curve. And this is using survival analysis. What we're looking at on day zero, essentially, 100% of the things are open. In other words, 0% have been patched. And then we look at how this goes down. And what's really interesting, you see this squiggly line, it sort of goes and drops and goes and drops. That's because a lot of the companies are scanning weekly. And so it's a 7-day cadence, that line sort of doing that, which is super interesting, I think. But it takes about 4 weeks to close about 25% of the vulnerabilities out there. And that, I think, is a huge revelation, because when we talk about, hey, this thing just broke, it's a vulnerability, how do we address it in the next day or two, right? Most companies aren't. 25% of vulnerabilities taking 4 weeks. It takes about 100 days, over 3 months, to get half of the vulnerabilities closed. And this is a lot of vulnerabilities. I think we're well into a billion vulnerabilities here that we're looking at the lifespan of these vulnerabilities. More than a quarter are still open after a year. And in the report, one of the things we do is that we show, we're looking at about 300 companies, I think, but we show each individual company. There's a lot of variation. There's a chart coming out in the report that you just can't read. It's just these squiggly lines on this type of chart, and it's just all over the place. But this is essentially the trend line that we're seeing across all these different varying maturity of organizations.
So two takeaways here. The first is, if you want to be better than the median, make sure your SLAs are faster than these. And the second thing is something we were hallway track talking about earlier, which is if you're worried about disclosure or actually scanning your infrastructure because you're afraid people will freak out at the number of issues, know that even if patches don't exist or even if the process takes a long time, that's generally true for everybody. It might take 100 days to patch half the vulnerabilities, and so making people aware of it as early as possible is probably more important than assuming that they'll get it done in 7 or 14 days.
Another way to look at that, remember we had 25%, 50%, 75% closed in that line. If we take those 3 points and break them out across vendors and rate them like this, what we see at the top is Microsoft getting 25% of the vulnerabilities closed in 2 weeks for Microsoft products, taking 134 days to get to 75%, which is really amazing. And this is almost, I think, a case for auto-patching. If you look at the top few in there, you get Microsoft and Google with Chrome. Every time you close Chrome, it tries to auto-update if it needs to. Debian and Red Hat, those are part of the operating system. And then you get down on the bottom, you get things that aren't that way, right? Obviously, Oracle is down there, HP, IBM, Cisco, Apache. And so you see this really drawn-out line on these vendors.
Also tells you something about what people are actually doing. Auto-patching works. But this chart tells you that people restart their browsers less often than they patch their Microsoft servers. And that's mind-blowing. That's a testament to how easy Microsoft has made it to do so, but also what the business priority is. If browser restarts were built in or browser restarts were forced, maybe that Google remediation timeline would be much faster. So this is one of those facets that we look at when we think about how can we be better at remediation, how can we be better at remediating things that do have exploits, because sometimes it's harder for different products and you expect the timeframes to be different. What we want to do next is we want to step away from speed and think about how do you create a strategy that is the right one for your business. And that could mean that you have a certain risk tolerance and you want to achieve it. You don't know whether your resources are good enough to get there, but you have some idea about how quickly you've been historically patching. That could mean that you don't know all the threats that are out there and you need to get better data. But overall, there are two metrics that Jay's going to walk you through, and then we'll look at what they look like applied to different strategies that are important in a vulnerability management practice. Those metrics are coverage and efficiency. They're the basis for the entirety of the report. They also happen to be how machine learning models are built in practice, not just in security, but in legal document review and cancer screening. The efficiency metric is really a precision metric. So when you make a decision to remediate something, how likely is it that that decision is correct? How much of the time are you making the right decision? And the coverage metric is, of all the things that are out there that you want to address, is your strategy really addressing them? There's a natural trade-off between the two, and I'll let Jay walk you through it.
Yep, so Michael talked about efficiency and coverage, and for anybody familiar with the information theory, as Michael mentioned, it's precision and recall. But of course, precision and recall are not very intuitive terms, and slightly more intuitive, hopefully, is efficiency and coverage. So efficiency is asking, how efficient is your activity? Out of everything that you chose to do, how efficient is that? So for example, there's a chart here on the left looking at the true positive, false positives, all those. But essentially, if you, let's say you go and patch 100 things, how many of those are being exploited? And if, let's say, 10 out of the 100 are being exploited, your efficiency is about 10%. Now, coverage, on the other hand, says, how many should I patch? How many of these things are being exploited? And then how many out of those 100, or how many of those that I should patch, did I patch? So if there's 100 that you need to patch and you only patch 10 out of those, your coverage then is 10%. So if we apply this to something like CVSS 10, the formatting is off on the slides here, which is interesting. But the efficiency here, what we see for CVSS 10, you can see on the left there for the true positives and the false positives, these are what you're patching in that circle, right? So you patched about 6,500 things that are rated as CVSS 10, and only 1,500 are in fact being exploited or that are being exploited out of CVSS 10. So what you see is 1,500 over 6,500, and you get about 23% efficiency. The coverage, you want to do the 20,000 plus the 1,500, and you're only doing about 7% of those that you should be patching. So if you just said patch all CVSS 10, what you get is about 23% efficiency, 7% coverage, and then the question we want to know is that good, right? We need something to compare that against. So let's take that same amount, 6,500, and what if we just randomly select CVEs? We have no priority whatsoever. We're doing it with a dice roll, with a random number generator, whatever. We get about 23% efficiency and 7% coverage. So this is CVSS 10, right? And we can take this same approach and go right down the line and apply it to the other ones.
So this is mind-blowing. For the first time, we're not just assessing a vulnerability, we're assessing our assessment process and our remediation strategy. And what we find is that our scoring systems aren't working. They're as good as random. A good strategy will be one that increases both of those metrics to a degree where we know that we sliced some things out, we chose to remediate some things, and as a result of that, we're not wasting time, we're more efficient, or we're covering more threats. None of that is happening with CVSS 10. Yeah. If you look at the full breakdown chart, and these are essentially decisions, cutoffs. A lot of enterprises do this. They'll say, we fix highs and critical. We fix critical and high. That would be CVSS 7 and above. And so the strategy of 7 and above, if you go down this table, is actually better than random. You'll remediate, you'll have 31% efficiency and 53% coverage. And take a look at the very bottom, the strategy of remediating CVSS 5 and above. You know, the efficiency is still better than random, it's at 26%, and your coverage goes up to 80%, almost 81%. That sounds fantastic. Except when you take a step back and you realize that 100% coverage is actually a really easy strategy. You just have to remediate every vulnerability in your environment. The problem with that strategy is that it's very costly. So if you look at the number of vulnerabilities that you would have to remediate in order to get to a strategy of CVSS 7+, you would delay 47,000 vulnerabilities, but you would essentially remediate 36,500 vulnerabilities. And the work of doing that, the work of going through about 30% of the vulnerabilities that are out there, is time. And in that time lag, exploitations happen. In that time lag, you don't have enough precision, and you're still only correct about 1/3 of the time. And that's the best you can do with CVSS. But I think that there are other measures, and there's other information out there that we can use to augment these strategies to make them not too much work while also increasing those metrics. So one such strategy that we take a look at in the first report is the vendor-based strategy. You know, maybe CVSS 10 Microsoft vulnerabilities really matter and our efficiency would be 80%. This is an awesome chart, but don't read too much into it. It's essentially telling you of the vulnerabilities that a vendor has released, what proportion of them have an exploit. So if you look at Microsoft, they kind of are on that chart between them, are on that line between them. Things that are below the line are vendors where there are more exploits. Exploits represent a larger proportion of the vulnerabilities that are released. And on the left-hand side of it are vendors that fewer of their vulnerabilities have exploitation events on them or exploits on them. But if you look at Google, that's just because they release a lot of vulnerabilities. That doesn't mean that they're any less risky or less likely to have a vulnerability on them. If you look at something like Adobe, maybe that is indicative of attackers actually go after those vulnerabilities more often. So let's take a look at that strategy. If you look at remediating the top five vendors and remediating all of the vulnerabilities as they come out for those, you do significantly worse than random. Only 12.5%, 12% efficiency, 12% coverage, and you're still remediating about 20,000 vulnerabilities. And that doesn't get significantly better as you expand your scope out to look at more prevalent vendors or vendors that have more exploits on them. And that's because we're looking at the wrong data. So what we really want to do is we want to build a model that incorporates all of the metadata that we have about vulnerabilities. The descriptions themselves are text-based, but they come from the vendors themselves, they come from NVD, they come from third-party sources like IBM X-Force, where people write up things about the vulnerability, and it's a text-based document, it's their assessment of it. But in that language is a lot of information. Information like, is this a remote code execution? Is this a buffer overflow? Which products does this affect? What's the mechanism the vulnerability gets exploited by? Sometimes they'll tell you how they found it, and that's an indication that an exploit already exists. There's also all sorts of other data in there, like how many vendors are affected by this, how many people have referenced this vulnerability, which products across a vendor are affected. We take all of that data together, along with all of the exploit data that we've mined out, and we start to build a model that incorporates all of these data sources, not just one of them, all these data points. And what we get there is, and this is the random forest model, right?
Yep.
Yes. So this is a random forest model that essentially looks at the whole corpus of data about a vulnerability and tries to make a decision or assign a score to it that says, this is the probability with which we think this vulnerability will have an exploit event or exploitation, an exploit published or an exploitation. And so what we find by building that model, which you could build with 5 variables, you could build with 20, there's easy ways to do this. And if you look at the reports, volume 1 and 2, we walk you through that process and how to get the data in an open source format as well. Then you start to see efficiency of about 80% and coverage of about 30%. And you can choose which cutoff you make. So the model's output is a score from 0 to 1. And you make a decision about both your capacity and what risk tolerance you have. If your CISO says we need to remediate 50% of all the known threats out there, then you know that to be at 60% coverage, the best efficiency that you could have, given the data at your disposal, is about 60%. If you think that you can't afford to waste 40% of your time and you want to be more precise, great. Start with the highly efficient strategy and remediate only those vulnerabilities where the efficiency is above 70%. So what does this look like? This is a graph of efficiency to precision, and what we're assessing here is the strategy itself. Let's walk all the way back to CVSS and look at CVSS 10. That dotted line that you see going through it is random efficiency. If you randomly pick a vulnerability, how efficient is that strategy? It's about 23%. And so is CVSS 10. But you see that CVSS 10 gets you only about 8% coverage or recall in this graph. CVSS 7 plus does significantly better, and you see it shifting to the top and to the right. And ultimately, if you wanted to have 100% coverage, you could do that by remediating every vulnerability. But the size of that bubble is the effort, or how many vulnerabilities you would have to remediate to achieve that strategy. So you could see the 10 bubble expanding to the 7 bubble. You're remediating 35,000 vulnerabilities to get there. And there's various strategies. You know, some of the reference lists are better or more predictive. They might have better efficiency or more coverage. But what's the real takeaway here is that there's a trade-off between coverage and efficiency. And we want to minimize effort, maximize coverage, maximize efficiency. The right way to do that is not by saying our policy is X. Our policy is critical vulnerabilities with exploits or Microsoft vulnerabilities on the bug track list. Because those are just slices of the data in half. They say we'll fix this, we won't fix this. And what that does is it creates a goal for you to achieve, and once you achieve it, you know that you've reached 40% efficiency in getting there and this much coverage. If you build a model, any model, this one, your own using exploitation data, your own using just the text-based data, it allows you to make decisions that are granular enough to be tailored to the capacity of your organization. Essentially, you want to start at the very top and remediate all the vulnerabilities where you know that the probability that they're going to be exploited or have an exploit is really high, and traverse that line down. What the goal you want to get to is what coverage trade-off you pick, so highly efficient, balanced, or broad coverage. And once you've done that, you know the path to getting there, and you know how efficient you'll be in getting to that path. More in reports volume 1 and 2 on that, but in the meantime, well, I walked through this. So essentially, the important part of this is that this is also a scoring system. It's just a scoring system that's using all of the data points that we have about vulnerabilities instead of the 6 facets of CVSS or the 9 facets if you're using CVSS temporal. You do half the work in the balance strategy, you get twice the efficiency and significantly improved coverage by using this model. And this model can also, of course, be significantly improved. That's how you assess your strategy. That's how you create a better strategy. But what's also interesting is this model is not just descriptive. This model also explains why some vulnerabilities get exploited, or at the very least, why we see exploits being released. And that's what we want to walk through next. The actual goal of this talk is to explain to you what is it about a vulnerability that's likely to have it be a risk to your organization. And in building this model and looking at how what contributes to high scores in the model is what we found.
So the previous stuff that Michael was just talking about is essentially looking at if a vulnerability is being exploited in the wild and or has a published exploit. In this section, we're actually going to do a slightly updated model and just look at exploitation in the wild. And now with that decision, what can happen is a published exploit, an exploit DB or Metasploit or something like that, can be used as an input variable. What is the increase in risk of some exploit being published? So what this is a little bit of an eye chart, and it's fuzzy because of the format of the slides here. But we've got this dotted line in the middle. All of these lines here are different parts of that metadata, different variables. And I'll walk through some of them here. But essentially, that dotted line in the middle, things on the right are going to increase the probability it's going to be exploited in the wild. Things on the left are going to decrease. These are going to be additive. So as vulnerabilities are tagged with different things, it'll bring it up and down. And then the length of the line is just our uncertainty about how much is contributing and things like that. So if I walk through this here, the red ones here are talking about published exploits. So at the very top, the most contributing variable is whether or not any published exploit exists. That's across any of the malware, any of the exploit kits, anything like that, any forums, any exploit DB, Metasploit, the Elliott framework. And so the very top one is, does any exist? And then we've got three specific repositories on where it could be published. So there's one that's going to increase it along with that one. And then these two are going to decrease from that first one. Because if any of these are red, or any of those are true, the any one is going to be true as well. So we also see vendors. So the CPE information, does that list specific vendors? And that's going to, a lot of these will contribute positively to identifying whether it's going to be exploited in the wild. We can also look at tags. So to just, a lot of the previous research just grabs the description from the CVE. We took it one step further. We scraped all of the references in the CVE, grabbed that text and started to do some keyword extraction and use those keywords to try and identify that. And then I got sick of making arrows, so I just said there's references. You know, what reference list is it on? What products are involved in the blue? And then CVSS variables, not a whole lot of them contributed a bunch to this model, but they're in there as well. So let's walk through an example. If there's nothing else present, if none of these are true, it's sort of an obscure thing, then there's about a 0.1% chance of exploitation. Now, if that's published in Metasploit, there's about a 40% chance of exploitation. So as soon as something shows up in Metasploit, this model is saying it's going to jump to about a 40% chance of exploitation in the wild. Now, if that's also from Microsoft, if Microsoft is tagged in that CPE, it's about an 81% chance of seeing that exploited in the wild. Now, by chance, if it's also in Exploit DB, the bottom one is going to lower that chance. Exploit DB is essentially more of a source code type of a thing, and you have to have some skill to grab that and exploit it. So actually, it decreases the overall chance of exploit in there with this model. Now, if we take a look at just the raw variables here, we see some things on top. The interesting thing, I think, here is the Microsoft reference. That's if Microsoft releases an advisory, right? And so not all Microsoft vulnerabilities get an advisory, but if there's a reference to where Microsoft has that advisory in the CVE itself, that's a highly contributing factor to it being exploited in the wild. Then we see other things like Symantec, Acrobat Excel, Drupal, Metasploit, ASP as a tag. And there, if the vulnerability is somewhere around the ASP stuff. On the negative side, we see things like Mac, OS X, Safari, being an Elliott DB. Also, the Exploit DB is down there. And then these tags. So it's interesting, like SQL injection and directory traversal, this is an interesting thing. This is not going to make it in the final model, because SQL injection and directory traversal in the data, generally, when they're found under generic rules. So like in an IDS system, it may just be able to capture and block SQL injection without saying this SQL injection attempt is associated with this CVE. So these things are getting a little blurry down here. But things like an authenticated service reduces the probability of exploitation. And then double free memory vulnerability, are people familiar with this? I had no idea what it was, but apparently these are much harder to exploit. They take a little bit more skill, a little bit more finesse to exploit. And so the fact that it's a double free memory vulnerability is going to lower the probability of exploitation in the wild.
And so all this to say that we've built a model and we're using that model both to prioritize vulnerabilities and to understand what is it about them that's contributing to the risk that they're posing to your organization. But how do we know that that model is good? How do we know that that model is right? How do we know that it's not just lucky sometimes? And so this is a calibration plot. Essentially what this plot is saying is if we, and it's good that it's along that line, what we wanted is we want it to be really tightly across that line, and we've got some overestimations and some underestimations here. But essentially what we're testing is if we say, you know, 10 vulnerabilities have an 80% chance of being successfully exploited with this model, then 80% of those will actually have an exploitation in the wild. So we're testing as to how the model is performing. What we're seeing is that for about 80% of vulnerabilities, the ones at the very bottom there, the probability that they're going to get exploited is less than 5%. And when you test that in the real world, that's true. If the model is predicting something that's less than 80%, then those aren't actually going to get exploited. As you go up higher, it becomes harder and harder to be certain that something is going to get exploited. So you'll see that this model, which is a work in progress and hopefully will do better, when you hit about 60%, then slightly more than 60% of those do get actually exploited. If I say something has a 60% chance of being exploited in this model, then maybe 65% of the vulnerabilities that I've labeled as such will have exploitation events. And there's a confidence band that's getting tighter at the top. But in the middle range, the vulnerabilities where we might not have a Microsoft advisory, we might not have a Metasploit, maybe it's an exploit DB and that's a noisy database, if we say something has a 40 or 50% chance of being exploited, the model is performing worse there. It's the in-between stage where we have some variability and some noise. But overall, if you take a step back, this is a well-calibrated model. It's significantly better than using something like CVSS. It's telling you that we're training a probability score now, something that can be used in real risk assessment, something that can be used to determine forecasts for how much risk you have in your organization or how much capacity you need to do it. And it's performing more or less as you would expect. When you issue a forecast that it's going to rain, it rains with that chance or that probability for the most part.
Yep.
So we're going to work on this model in the future. You can see that it's, you know, good, decent, better. But as you add more data, as you get more precise exploitation data, as you get more data sources from other vendors about what is and what isn't being exploited, that model should get tighter, and we hope to present that in the future. And the takeaways are that to understand something also gives you the power to be able to prioritize it and to predict it. And that's what I hope we've shown in this slide.
And this is something that we're going to open up, by the way. As soon as we get something good that we can share and have it documented well, we're going to be sharing that. So hopefully this summer, I think, is what we're shooting for.
Yeah. And by open up, we mean both the data and the model itself. Hopefully we'll publish live so that you can just grab it down and run it through an Excel spreadsheet.
Yep. All right. So the takeaways here. One of the things that we hope you do is that you go back and look at your own vulnerability efforts. We talked about the efficiency, the coverage. If you guys can go back and start to look at your own process, see how you can start looking at your performance, see if you can gather this information and show how you're doing, right? Then another thing in the next month or so, I'm sure wherever you're working, you've got sensors that are picking up exploitation attempts. You've got logs, some are showing this stuff. Try to start capturing those. That's going to be your target information. Those are the ones that you know for sure need to be in those when you're looking at your efficiency and coverage. Right? Then within 6 months, once you've got your target data and you're looking at your own efforts, start to track and calculate your own coverage and efficiency. I think that, and share it with us, if you wouldn't mind. And also your capacity too. It's another thing in the new report we're gonna be talking about is capacity, so. And then look at other strategies. Try to think of what your strategy is for selecting what you're going to patch. And then once you're recording this stuff, you can compare and try to possibly improve on the strategy that you're using. And again, a lot of research that we're still doing here, a lot of stuff still coming out. Like I said, our third volume of research is coming out next week. Kenna is publishing that. And we're trying to get as much of this out in the open as we can, so.
Yep. Yeah, take a look at your own capacity, how many vulnerabilities you can remediate in a month or you do remediate in a month, and think about the models that we've shown or maybe the models you end up building, how does capacity trade off with that? That's the question that we want to answer in the next report. To which end, Wade Baker has t-shirts back there from the Cyentia Institute. Jay did forget to mention it. Grab a t-shirt, it'll remind you to look at the report when it comes out on Tuesday, and let us know what you think. Thank you.
And with that, we'll open to questions. Yes, sir.
Do we have time for questions?
I think so.
Yeah.
Okay, you sit back down. It's gonna be a good question. seriously, though, I really found your data analysis of this fascinating, so thank you for sharing it with us. I'm going to ask you a question a little bit about other applications of this kind of data or this type of model. Mm-hmm. So, you know, Rob Joyce from NSA was speaking earlier this week. He had in the past been on TV about, you know, government process for deciding whether to release a zero day if the government finds it. Mm-hmm. And I think that's applicable to anybody who searches for vulnerabilities, governments or whoever.
Right.
Can you use this type of model to decide, in some sense, the urgency or importance of what you do with a zero day? If you have this description yourself, but it's not yet out in the public, yep. Can you use it to aid that decision process?
So first, this model is not necessarily specific to this. I mean, this is just machine learning. It's just some regression analysis. So the key with that is you would almost have to try some, release some, and see how they perform and record it, and hold back some and see what happens also, because what you need is a target variable, right? You need to know, you need some estimation of what happens when I do this, right? And luckily we have that. We've got exported in the wild. Got all these attributes, and so in order to really test that, you need that target variable to look at how the decisions have performed. Mm. So it's that feedback loop, and in order to assess in that situation, you need that feedback loop.
Yeah. Okay, so. Thanks.
Yeah.
Did you want to ask a follow-up to that, Greg? Okay.
So could you retroactively do that with vulnerabilities that are exploited in the wild without having already had a CVE or CVSS entry?
Yes. Yeah, but there's a big but on that one. The getting data around that is super hard. So like when they don't have a CVE, trying to capture all of those. So like we were going through all the Ruby vulnerabilities,
right.
And they were, I can't even begin to count them. You know, and it's like this library of this package and this gem has this one line that has this vulnerability, and it's like, okay, how are we going to track that? The IDS scanners aren't necessarily picking that up. The source code scanners, we might be able to get something from that. But.
Well, so this is the key point of CVE. Why we started with that ontology is that it's all possible because it all pivots on a CVE. The scanners use the same thing to record it. The IDS signatures use the same thing to record it. The malware reversals use the same thing to record it. If that doesn't exist, we can't put all that same data in the same place and relate it to the same entity.
So you don't have data on when a vulnerability
was
exploited in the wild.
Right, yeah,
well,
we don't have.
So when it was exploited as one, but you also don't know whether an exploit actually exists. You know that maybe somebody's exploiting it, but you don't know if there's weaponized code for it. It might be for a different vulnerability. It might be a different attack against the same framework. And you also don't know if anybody's remediating that vulnerability or not. You know that they might be upgrading versions, but
so
that's about it.
One of the things we're thinking about with that is if you look at vulnerabilities that don't have a CVE, what are their characteristics? And so if we say, you know, what information can we get about software libraries in Ruby, you know, and maybe we see that there's a 2% chance of exploitation for that. So if we abstract it up a layer, instead of saying, what's the chance of this vulnerability, saying this vulnerability is like these other ones, and these other ones have these characteristics, right? And so it becomes a little bit more abstract, but I think that's the approach that we're taking right now is to say, like, this is a custom application. There's no way it's ever going to get a CVE. It's this one enterprise that has this code. But this vulnerability has these attributes. It's exploited in this way. It's remote code execution. It's not remote, you know, and has these attributes. Then we might be able to use those attributes and say, for the CVEs with these attributes, we see this proportion being exploited. So.
Oh, sorry, go ahead. I already had one.
All right.
Okay.
Excuse me.
We're being told that we have to clear out the room. So we'll be heading out. We'll be in the hallway for a while.
Okay.
So thank you.